Roger was an active member of Peace Lutheran Church, serving as a trustee. He also spent many years as a volunteer fireman for the Wall Lake Fire Department. In recent retirement years, gardening, golfing, fishing, playing cards, coffeeing at Doc's place, and going south for the winter all helped keep Roger a busy and happy man. Riding on the bike trails near Wall Lake with Marlene and the grandkids was also a fun summer activity for him. Special enjoyment came from the domino and euchre clubs that he and Marlene attended monthly with their close friends. Roger's wife, children, and grandchildren were the highlight of his life. He was certainly a hard worker, a dedicated volunteer, and a person who enjoyed a variety of hobbies. But his most precious time was always with family. He was a devoted husband, caring father, and proud grandfather that everyone could depend on for unconditional love and support. It was plain to see that Roger delighted in every opportunity spent with his five grandchildren at his home, their homes, and at their various activities. Whether he was helping a son move dirt with the tractor, hanging wallpaper in the kitchen, or loaning his new truck to transport equipment from the studios in Cedar Rapids to Arizona, or watching a grandchild while parents worked late, Roger always made time to help his kids. Whether it meant helping a grandson build a snowman for the first time, building a fence in the backyard to keep this grandson and granddaughter in the backyard, or showing the grandkids how to take care of the vegetable garden, or maybe giving them a ride on the lawnmower, letting them try out the new golf cart, having tickets from the farm festival kiddie rides, riding in a paddle boat, or being the proud spectator at tennis meets, school concerts, and volleyball games. Roger always found time to share these special moments with each member of the family. In return, he frequently commented that he didn't know what he'd done to deserve such wonderful children and grandchildren. Roger and Marlene had long planned to have a party this September for their 45th wedding anniversary. While that simply wouldn't happen, they fortunately did have a wonderful celebration back in 1997, hosted by their children in honor of their 35th anniversary. Family and friends gathered in the Arcadia Legion Hall, the same site where Roger and Marlene first met, where they first danced, and where Roger had first asked permission to drive Marlene home.
I remember he had a car. It was kind of a cream-colored car, and inside he painted it with house paint. That was our first date, and I thought, oh my gosh.
What am I getting into?
What is this?
They celebrated this memorable event with a wonderful dinner and a family video of their years together, followed by a few laughs shared with a comedian. While these are all wonderful chapters written into Roger's book of life by our great author above, none of us ever expected the pages to unfold as they have for Roger in the past few weeks. While doctors struggled to find a reason for Roger's failing health, and family and friends prayed for answers, no one ever wanted these answers to unfold. For knowing the reason behind Roger's illness brought no satisfaction to answered prayers. Instead, those answers brought about more reason for us to carefully consider what we ask for in prayer. As Roger struggled to be strong for us during his final days on earth, we were touched by the subtle ways each of us found special moments with him. The silent moments by his bedside, the hand-holding during difficult days, the nursing procedures we learned to help him with, the plastic cross on a string of yarn proudly created and presented to him by the youngest grandson, or a Build-A-Bear designed by the youngest granddaughter with him in mind as she carefully placed the heart inside with a wish and a prayer for Grandpa Roger to get better. or the oldest grandchild, specially editing, framing, and displaying photos of Grandpa and Grandma during happier times. Or another grandchild, lighting candles at the hospital chapel and reading Psalm 23 every night before bedtime. Or the strolls down the hospital hallways with a proud grandson pushing the wheelchair and sharing his happenings of the day, even though it scared Grandpa just a bit to know that he drove the tractor all by himself. We find comfort in knowing that our great author above has written many wonderful chapters for Roger's life here on earth, and will continue with even more blessed chapters with his life in heaven. As Roger joins those who preceded him in death, his father, Emil Schmidt, his brother and sister-in-law, Larry and Diane Schmidt, and his father-in-law and mother-in-law, Charles and Louise Dierenfeld, we pray that the Lord will fill Roger's heavenly pages with nothing but peace, joy, love, and comfort. Roger, you will be lovingly remembered by your wife, Marlene, of 45 years, your honey bunch by your hospital bedside, and your three children and their spouses, Alan Karen Schmidt of Cedar Rapids, Iowa, Dan and Kathy Schmidt of Wall Lake, Iowa, and Angie and Randy Meyer of Johnston, Iowa. Roger will also be fondly remembered by his five grandchildren, Amber and Austin Schmidt, Taylor and Nicole Schmidt, and Spencer Meyer, who will also warmly remember you as Grandpa Schmidt, Grandpa Roger, and Papa, respectively. Many other family and wonderful friends will be forever touched by the pages shared among your book of life and theirs.
I'm glad that Spencer was able to know as Papa, and I will always share stories and pictures of you. My dad, my friend, and my hero. I love you, Dad.
What a great life. Editing this video has been the hardest project I've ever done. With every picture, there's a couple stories to tell. Easily, this could have been a 2-hour movie. Thanks for all the memories, the helping hand, and the life lessons along the way. I love you, Dad.
Don't blink, just like that. You're 6 years old and you take a nap, and you wake up and you're 25. Then your high school sweetheart becomes your wife. Don't blink, you just might miss your babies growing like mine did, turning into moms and dads. Next thing you know, you better have a 50 years is there in bed. And you're praying God takes you instead. Trust me, friend, 100 years goes faster than you think. So don't blink.
Finally death came calling for the small town southern man. He said it's alright, 'cause I see angels and they got me by the hand. Don't you cry and don't you worry, I'm blessed and I know I am. 'Cause God has a place in heaven for a small town southern man. And he bowed his head to Jesus, and he stood for Uncle Sam, and he only loved one woman, was always proud of what he had. He said his greatest contribution is the ones he'll leave behind. Raised on the ways and gentle kindness of a small town southern man. Raised on the ways and gentle kindness of a small town southern man.
So, although we miss you dearly, and our hearts are aching terribly, Roger, we rejoice that you are safely home again at the end of the day, this time sitting at the table with God the Father Almighty.